Welcome to the National Decommissioning Centre and our simulator suite. I'm Richard Neilson, Centre Director. We're delighted to have the system complete and to be able to showcase it. We've partnered with the Offshore Simulator Centre in Norway to provide a unique facility in the northeast of Scotland, but one which has global reach. The system provides us with the capability of undertaking marine simulation and data visualisation, analysis and decision making. Let me take you around the suite. The suite comprises three main areas: the dome, in which we have the real-time controls, the control room and our debriefing room. We'll start in the control room. The main station is where we'll do the initial build of a simulation, setting up the scene and pulling in vessels, cranes, remote operated vehicles or ROVs and other items from our library in what's termed the sandbox. The other three stations in this room allow other staff to interact with or modify the simulation real-time, while people are performing tasks or operations in the same scene within the dome. For example, during a simulation, the sea state could be modified to see the effect of this during the operation. Across from these stations, we have the debriefing room, where we can analyse and rerun simulations to allow the team to discuss the outcomes. If we need to present to more people, we can export the output to our 6-metre screen in our hub area. Moving into the dome, we have the main display and real-time control area. This contains 4 individual control stations, 2 for controlling vessels and 2 which control either cranes or ROVs. The controls on these stations interact with the simulation in real time, allowing the user to perform the required operations and see the results. This allows us to trial operations or new technologies in a safe virtual environment, simulating all of the physics in real time before deploying them in real life. To show the overall capability of the system, we'd like to show 2 examples. The first is a straightforward lift of a piece of subsea equipment, and the second is a trial of a new technology. Our first example is a subsea lift based on the Strathspey manifold. Here, we see the manifold being lifted from the seabed. The lift is being undertaken by a construction vessel with knuckle boom crane, which recovers the manifold for placement on the rear deck. The video for this operation was undertaken in real time in the dome using one of our control chairs. As can be seen, the motion of the system is replicated well. Here we can see the manifold swinging as it comes through the splash zone, and later when the movement of the crane is started and stopped. In the simulation, the manifold is landed on the deck of the vessel. This is difficult given the space constraints. To show the flexibility of the system, we can rerun the simulation but introduce a barge to show how the operation would change if the manifold were to be loaded onto a barge instead of the back of the vessel itself. In this clip, the manifold is already out of the water, and we now pull in a barge from the library or sandbox. This is done in real time. Once the barge is loaded into the simulation, we can position it alongside the lift vessel. We can then add a tug to pull the barge and add in the cables for towing. The operation continues and the manifold is lowered onto the barge. Finally, once the lifting cables are removed, we can move the barge away with the tug. We've partnered with Axelos to enhance the simulations by linking them to fast finite element analysis. We've used the manifold as an exemplar and have started the process of interfacing the two systems. Our second example is a trial of new technology, ACOS IP's ambient linear system, being used to remove a segment of conductor and move it to a basket on the seafloor and then recover it to a vessel. The simulation starts with the conductor being disconnected from the jacket and the weight being taken by the ambient linear buoyancy system. The ROV is then manoeuvred out of the jacket. It then transits to an underwater basket, which is used to recover the conductor segments. The ROV comes in and engages with the basket and lowers the conductor segment while the buoyancy in the ambient linear unit is adjusted to maintain the required trim. The basket is then recovered to surface and loaded onto the vessel for shipment to shore. I mentioned earlier that as well as marine simulation, we can use the simulator as a tool to visualise datasets and model the interactions between them to allow us to make better decisions. This will allow us to look at possible benefits of campaigns for decommissioning, how to go about decommissioning as we move to a net zero environment, and some of the big challenges around energy transition and integration. Our priority project, which we've called Smart Basin, is to build a virtual model of the entire North Sea. Our aim is to map all the offshore assets, including oil and gas and renewables. For this, we'll draw on data from databases like the Oil and Gas Authority's National Data Repository. Once these are in place, we can overlay data, including likely cessation of production dates for oil and gas assets, dates when renewable power will come online and the scale of these resources, possible carbon capture and storage systems, etc. We'll then be able to model the interaction between these and help stakeholders and decision makers in assessing the best options. We've started already with an exemplar area east of Shetland. This region is of interest as there is a possibility of optimising decommissioning and look at interactions with the Norwegian sector. We'll then expand to southern North Sea, which is interesting because of the proximity between ageing oil and gas assets and renewable energy sources, and the possibility of repurposing of some of the oil and gas assets to renewable hubs. We've started collecting data about the assets to initiate the build. To demonstrate the possibilities on a more accessible scale, we've built a model of Aberdeen and are starting to collect data which can be superimposed on it. Our first piece of work around this will be a collaborative study with the City Council and the Aberdeen Harbour Board of any changes in traffic flow caused by the new south basin of the harbour and the effects of different link roads. We hope this has been of interest and we look forward to discussing projects with you.